Good evening and welcome to tonight's meeting in the Commonwealth Club of California. Find us on the internet at commonwealthclub.org. I'm John Geschke, partner at the law firm of Cooley, Gawker, Cronish, and your chair for tonight's program. Tonight's program is part of a series of programs underwritten by the Geschke family, which examines the U.S. Constitution in the 21st century. Since the September 11th al-Qaeda attacks on the World Trade Center and the Pentagon, the U.S. has been on the equivalent of a wartime footing. This period of time has given rise to specific legislation and practices that present significant challenge to the core provisions of the U.S. Constitution protecting civil liberties and freedom of speech. There are challenges to the right of habeas corpus, challenges to the Posse Comitatus Act, which limits the powers of the federal government to use the military for law enforcement, and curtailment of First Amendment rights to free speech and freedom of assembly. An additional area of challenge, the practice of presidential exclusions, goes to the root of the separation of powers provided in the U.S. Constitution. Walking the line between protecting U.S. security and curbing the rights of U.S. citizens is a delicate business. A government's first duty is to protect its citizens against threats to their security. Yet starting down the path of restricting civil liberties can be a very slippery slope. The Commonwealth Club's series on the U.S. Constitution in the 21st century will examine the balance between safety, security, and public order on the one hand, and the protection of civil liberties and the integrity of the Constitution on the other. This series aims to break new ground by delving into recent interpretations of the U.S. Constitution and discussing potential new directions for the Obama administration. To this end, it's now my pleasure to introduce tonight's distinguished speaker, Jane Mayer, correspondent for The New Yorker and author of the best-selling book, The Dark Side, The Inside Story of How the War on Terror Turned into a War on American Ideals, a book chosen by The New York Times as one of the 10 best books of 2008. Jane Mayer joined The New Yorker as a staff writer in March 1995. Based in Washington, D.C., she writes about politics for the magazine, including the War on Terror. Recent subjects Ms. Mayer has covered include the Pentagon's secret torture policy, how the United States outsources torture through rendition, the prison in Guantanamo Bay, and the legality of CIA interrogations. Before joining The New Yorker, Ms. Mayer was a reporter at The Wall Street Journal for 12 years. In 1984, she became the journal's first female White House correspondent. Ms. Mayer was a winner of the John Chancellor Award for Excellence in Journalism and a Guggenheim Foundation Fellowship in 2008, as well as the Ridenhour Book Prize. She's been a finalist for a National Magazine Award and was nominated twice by The Wall Street Journal for a Pulitzer Prize in the feature writing category. Ms. Mayer will be in conversation with Mary Cranston, senior partner at the law firm of Pillsbury Shaw Pittman and chair of the Commonwealth Club's Board of Governors. And now, please join me in welcoming Jane Mayer along with Mary Cranston.
We're so happy to have you here today, and I know this audience is very excited about our conversation. I expect to get a lot of questions from the audience, but let me get started, and then we'll just start bringing the questions up, and I'll start asking them as well. Not everyone in the audience may have gotten all the way through the book. I personally found it an incredibly interesting book and extremely informative and surprising in many ways, and I thought maybe we might start by having you just kind of give the audience some of the, for you, the highlights of your insights and some of the surprises you came across as you researched this book.
Okay, thank you very much. Thanks for everybody for coming. This book was the result of stories I did for The New Yorker. I did about a dozen stories that were related to it, and I tried to put them together in a book really for a specific purpose. I felt that the way news breaks kind of out of order, it was hard to see the true big narrative here, because something like Abu Ghraib, the story would break in the spring of 2004, and you really wouldn't know what was behind it and what had built up to it. So I kind of rearranged all the stories and kind of broke them into pieces and put it back together chronologically with a particular thought in mind, which was to sort of restore accountability and connect the dots between what was happening in Washington and what was happening around the world so that you could see what decisions were being taken in Washington and how they played out in sort of dungeons basically around the world. So that was the point behind the book, and the high points along the way, I mean, to me really this whole subject from the start from the first story that I got into was so shocking. I felt that this just did not seem like the country that I identify with as our country. Many of the practices that I discovered along the way here, and I majored in American history at Yale, and I went on and studied American history at Oxford, so I was certainly familiar with ups and downs in our history, but to come across a program in the CIA where government officials worked in black ski masks and basically abducted terror suspects around the world by throwing them into the back of a Gulfstream jet, and you know, after they had stripped their clothes off by slicing them off with sort of razors and putting these people in diapers and then just disappearing them from the face of the earth. I think that's really the thing that was so amazing to me, was we're a country so based on the notion of due process and the idea that all people have inalienable rights, including the right to be free from cruel and unusual punishment. These things are so fundamental to our fabric, and yet these programs completely ignored that. And so the rendition program was a surprise. And in the beginning, I thought that it was not possible that the top of our government really knew the details of what was going on in some of these really horrible spots. I somehow figured that these were rogue officers who got carried away, as they said of Abu Ghraib, that it was a few rotten apples. And so one of the other surprises to me was that not only were the people at the top of our government aware of what was going on and authorizing what was going on, but there were literally transcripts of those interrogations that have detailed notes about all the things that happened to these people that were in files on the desk of the director of the Central Intelligence Agency, and I think probably in Cheney's office as well. So for a while I couldn't believe they really knew, and I spoke to somebody at the CIA who said to me, and knows a lot about this, I said, "Do you mean to say that they actually understood really what was going on here?" After I'd heard so many accounts of some of the horrible things. And this person said, "Yeah, I'd like to tell you that there was adult supervision, but there wasn't." And the lack of judgment at the top of our government was completely shocking to me. And then finally, the last thing that I thought was kind of a eureka moment for me was when I stumbled into finding that there was actually a curriculum for torture. Because I had been, as a reporter, looking around the world wondering, how could it be that all the same kinds of abuse are cropping up wherever the U.S. was holding terror suspects? So it was in Iraq, and you'd see it in Guantanamo, and you would see it in Afghanistan. The same thing, people in hoods, people with their, you know, in stressed positions and chained and being subjected to incredibly strange things. I remember there was a report in the New York Times that said that people were being bombarded with the sound of cat food commercials. So they'd be hearing meow, meow, meow all the time. And I was just, you know, wondering, well, where are they getting these ideas? And so it was obvious that it couldn't be just a spontaneous sort of combustion thing. And so I was interviewing people at the Pentagon, and I spoke to one top official there, and I said, you know, where are you getting these interrogation ideas? And he said, oh, well, you know, there's a program for it, and it has an acronym, and psychologists from this program have designed it. And he said, it has something to do with survival and evasion. And so I went back to my desk, and I Googled. And since we're out, you know, in the land of Silicon Valley, Google's very helpful for reporters. And I Googled, and up came survival, evasion, resistance, escape. SEER is the acronym for the program. It's a secret program in our own military training, and it's a program where they use psychologists who are specialists in torture, and they subject our own, you know, soldiers to a taste of torture just to make sure that they can survive it if they're ever captured. And the CIA, right after 9/11, took those psychologists and hired them to build this curriculum for torture. And we wound up with the United States using all the techniques that we had studied that our worst enemies had ever used. And they were, you know, communist techniques that were used by Stalin, and they were used in the Korean War. They were communist Chinese techniques. And things that we had reviled became our own program. So I think that was kind of a eureka moment, finding that there was this curriculum.
If we go back to the beginning, and your book talks a lot about the changes in the war powers post 9/11, could you kind of give an overview of how you saw this process evolving with the catastrophe in New York and then congressional action and Department of Justice action that all sort of in a certain way led to the activities that you've described in your book? And how did that all happen?
It happened fast. I mean, one of the things that's sort of remarkable about this whole period is that there was panic inside the White House, understandably, I think, after 9/11, and great fear that it would happen again. And it was in this mindset, yeah, I mean, the point of terrorism is to terrorize people, and it was in that period that there were a lot of decisions taken quickly, and the decisions were to do everything that they could legally could to protect the country. And so the judgment was made that they were not going to make policy choices other than just going to the farthest edges of the law. And then they had lawyers who interpreted the farthest edges as being further out than anybody had ever interpreted them before. So basically, they worked with the Office of Legal Counsel in the Justice Department, which gave the president authority to go above the law in the name of national security.
What was the role of Vice President Cheney and George Tenet, the director of the CIA, in this evolution?
Cheney, I think we begin to see more and more, is kind of the locus of this program. So many fingerprints go back to Cheney's office, and it sprung out of his mindset, his sort of dark view of human nature, and some of his political preconceptions, which were that you need a strong executive to protect the country, and he basically has very little respect for Congress. When he was a congressman, he described Congress as a bunch of gnats, and he felt that they needed to be as tough or tougher than the rest of the world that we were dealing with. So, I mean, that's why I've used his phrase, the dark side, as the name of this book. He said, we're going to have to go to the dark side and do what these people do. And in that statement, it was given the first weekend after 9/11, he was pretty much, I think, saying, we're going to fight this war in a way we never have before. We're going to use the tactics of our enemies. We're going to, you know, do it in the shadows, he said, too.
And your afterword has some very interesting mentions of some comments that Cheney has made since he left office that relate to these events, and maybe you could talk a little bit about that.
Well, I mean, Cheney, I mean, we all know, I think, probably because he's been so visible recently. It's amazing after years of being so invisible. But he pretty much came out and said, yes, I did it, and yes, I would do it again, and Obama is a fool not to do the same things, and talking about sort of using coercion or so-called enhanced interrogation techniques. He's really become the greatest defender of these kinds of techniques and has stepped right up to it. And, you know, interestingly, because somebody in the White House who I was interviewing said recently, every time he says this, he's just asking for an investigation. But I think he's doing it for exactly the opposite reason, to try to put the Obama administration on the defensive politically in case there is another attack.
Well, it's interesting, of course, since President Obama has taken office, there have been significant changes in the policies of the United States with respect to terror. And and I wondered if you could comment on some of those changes.
Well, there have been some very significant changes, I think, and there's some distance still to go. The first thing that Obama did in the first week he was in office was to sign a number of executive orders, I think there were three, that basically banned torture, recognized that the Geneva Conventions covers all prisoners held overseas by the United States, and he also closed down all of the CIA's secret black prison sites. So they were basically no longer going to disappear people off of the face of the earth. They recognized the right of the Red Cross to have access to all such prisoners. and they said that any prisoners that we held were going to be treated in humane ways, not in cruel and unusual ways. It would be illegal to do so. So that was a big deal. I think I give them a lot of credit for doing that and for doing it so fast. And after that, the question has been what to do moving forward with people who are down in Guantanamo. And there they are, they've given themselves 180 days to come up with some kind of solution. They're studying it. It gets them to the end of this month. I think it's July 21st that they have to report. And they've given themselves a year to close Guantanamo. So they're coming into all kinds of problems there, and that's probably what the the groan was about, because they've begun to sort of start to discuss things that seem very much like put them in the kind of danger zone that might have them doing some of the same things the Bush administration mm-hmm. did in terms of preventive detention.
You're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program, and our guest today is Jane Mayer, New Yorker correspondent and author, who is discussing U.S. national security and challenges to constitutional rights. I have a number of questions here about the role of the CIA, both before September 11th, through the Bush administration, and then the new leadership of the CIA now. I wondered if we could go back first to the CIA under the Clinton administration and the things that happened there that led to the miss on the potential threat of the bombings in New York.
Well, the CIA during the Clinton years, I mean, it's interesting. During the transition, when Bush came into office, Clinton's national security advisor, Sandy Berger, actually warned the Bush administration as they were taking office to pay close attention to al-Qaeda, and he said, this is your greatest threat. And what was interesting to me...
And Richard Clark also.
And Richard Clark as well. Richard Clark wrote memos saying, if you don't take this seriously soon, a day is going to come when there are going to be bodies in the streets. And he said this in, you know, the months leading up to 9/11. And the thing that's interesting is, given the sort of the... the very strong reaction that the Bush administration had after 9/11, they were really, you could almost argue, negligent before 9/11. They simply did not pay attention to this. They were forewarned by the Clinton people and then by their own people, Richard Clark, who is a nonpartisan expert in terrorism, who was on the NSC, and nobody could get the Bush administration's attention on this, really. And there was even a meeting, really, it was the week before 9/11, a National Security Council meeting, when they were still arguing about whether they should do anything about al-Qaeda, and nothing was really resolved at that meeting, too. And then a week later, this, you know, the attacks came. So you can see how they dropped the ball in many ways. And that's the White House end of it. At the same time, inside the CIA, there's a story that is absolutely pitiful, which is that the CIA had been tracking two of the people who later became the hijackers on 9/11, and they were tracking them around the world, and they learned that two of those hijackers came to America and came to California, in fact, but the CIA failed to notify the FBI. So the FBI didn't know they were here, and the CIA stopped following them because they were within the territorial USA, where it's the FBI's job. And so it was simply a bureaucratic breakdown. As far as I can tell, it was simply, and I interviewed people in the book, there's an FBI agent named Jack Clunan who's interviewed, who simply says, you know, it was just people not doing their jobs. And I quote George Tenet, who was the former director of the CIA, saying, well, the problem was we put paperwork in the wrong basket. You know, whatever it was, it's recognizable to anybody almost in a big office. But given that the solutions were so radical, the solutions were we had to turn our legal system upside down and break away from all the kind of human rights traditions that we had, when in fact the problem was not that our legal system was inadequate, as far as I can tell. Our problem was a bureaucratic bungle.
From what you can see, if we fast forward to today, have there been systemic changes in the CIA that would and its relationships to the FBI that would ameliorate this problem? Or
I mean, they're working on it. There continues to be sort of communication breakdowns between the FBI and the CIA. They're great rivals, but I know that I just interviewed Leon Panetta a couple weeks ago, who is now the new director of the CIA. And I know he's been having breakfast regularly with Bob Mueller, who is the director of the FBI. So I know that on the top they're talking. They're also trying to set up a new task force that is for interrogating terror suspects, where they're going to work together on it. They're trying to do, actually, it's pretty interesting. They're trying to put together something like they call it Manhattan Project for interrogation. They're trying to take the brightest people in the country who would know anything about interrogation, the best homicide detectives, the best people in the FBI, the CIA, linguists, and cultural anthropologists who would know about the culture out of which the terrorists might have sprung, and put them all together in these mobile units that are going to start to interrogate people. So they're trying to fix it, but Panetta said that he feels they're still not there, that he's worried about our ability to do this job right.
If you, based on all of your work and your thinking about this, if you had some comments to give to Leon Panetta or President Obama about what to do differently with respect to the CIA and the FBI, what would you tell them?
Gosh, I mean, truly, we were talking about this a little before. I consider myself a reporter, not necessarily a, political savant. So I'm not sure that I can tell them what to do, but I can tell you what I've learned from this, that what works and what doesn't work if you're going to try to fight terrorism. I do think we're going to have to win hearts and minds around the world. For every terrorist that you can kill or torture, there are so many more who are going to be radicalized by seeing our tactics, if our tactics seem to be violations of human rights. And everybody who I consider to be really sophisticated about this thinks that we have to win people's hearts and minds.
One very interesting story you had in the afterword of the book was that President Obama and his team went down to the CIA to look into the efficacy of torture, putting aside the morality of it, does it work? And it was a very interesting conclusion that Langley came up with. You might talk about that.
Yeah, this was during the transition period. Right before Obama signed these executive orders that banned torture, he took the extra step of sending emissaries over to Langley, the headquarters of the CIA, where they talked with the experts on terrorism over there. And the main question of the day was, do we need to use coercion in order to win the war on terror? And the answer was a ringing no, we don't need to do these things. So for all of the things that Cheney's been saying, the CIA experts who know most about this are saying, we don't need to do these things. And it's the same answer you get, and I've gotten over and over again, from the military. There's really no greater opposition to torture than you get from the top of our military establishment. They think it degrades us, they think it's counterproductive, and they think it's dangerous. They think it's dangerous for our own people if they're taken captive. There's no argument against torturing them. And same thing if you talk to the FBI, amazingly. And the FBI were my first sources on this story. And part of the reason I got into this and could tell how serious the subject was, that was the FBI was so upset, and they're not all members of the ACLU, and they're not, and they were really, I think, really deeply, they looked at this as a crisis of conscience for the country, because they felt that they were going to be asked to do things that they thought, one man said to me, Dan Coleman is his name, an FBI officer said to me, not only is this not going to work, but you lose your soul. And he didn't want to be put in that position. He kept talking about the suits in Washington are going to make us do these things to people, and we're going to lose our soul. And, his son was an Army Ranger. He's not, as I said, not a liberal, but he just thought this was really beneath the United States.
You know, along that line, we have a number of questions from the audience about what we should do about what happened. Do we look back? Do we prosecute lawyers and others who were involved in these aggressive positions on torture. What's your assessment about what we should do now about what happened in the Bush administration with respect to torture?
Well, you know, I mean, again, it gets me into the realm of sort of saying, you know, of opinion as opposed to being a fact reporter, but speaking just personally for myself, I feel that we have to do more. I feel that at the very least, we've got to get the facts out there. And there's a lot that's still not known. I mean, I put a ton of, everything I could find out is in this book, but there are gaps. It's hard to know who really dreamed up the idea of bringing those psychologists in and having them design a torture program. They didn't do it on their own. And who really brought in the doctors and other medical people who used their expertise, their scientific expertise, to be able to push prisoners to the edge of death but keep them from dying. You know, they just knew exactly where to stop. And we still don't know really who monitored that, who brought it in. And did it begin with Cheney? Did it begin with the CIA? Who pushed whom? Cheney's been saying the CIA asked for this authority. The CIA's been saying the White House made us do it. Who really did? You know, we don't know our own history in this area. And I guess I think that in a democracy, accountability is key. You know, just like in any organization, you have to know who's responsible. And it doesn't necessarily mean that you have to prosecute people, but I think you've just got to know what the story was here. And so I am in favor of at least some kind of investigation. And to tell you the truth, the U.S. legally has an obligation to do this under the Convention Against Torture. We're signatories to it. And the Convention Against Torture says that if there are allegations of torture, the country where they took place has to investigate. It's an affirmative obligation. You have to investigate, and you have to help bring some sort of justice for the victims. And it also says that if the host country, if we don't investigate, other signatories can and should and must. So that's why you see what's happening in Spain. They've begun to take steps towards investigating this, because if we don't, they will. And I think they're doing it basically to make us do it, or try to make us do it. I think we should take a closer look.
Have you talked to officials in the Obama administration about what they're planning to do?
Yeah, I mean, I have, and you know, I mean, I think it's not a secret. Obama's been very upfront about this. He wants to fix what went wrong, and then not look back. Because they see this, and I understand why they're arguing this. They see this as political quicksand. It's George Bush's mess. It's not Obama's agenda. He wants to move forward with his own positive agenda, healthcare and all the other things that he wants to do. He sees this as politically divisive. It could be accused of prosecuting his predecessors, and they want to avoid anything that sort of becomes a political culture war, and they think torture could be a political culture war. In order to keep their popularity moving forward, they want to hold the independents in their column and not alienate moderate Republicans and independents and conservative Democrats. So they look at this as just a political, you know...
Quagmire,
right.
We know the... obviously, the credibility and the confidence in both the competence and ethics of the CIA has been clear throughout this. How do you feel the CIA is doing now, and is there any reason to believe that it is behaving appropriately by American standards, and how would the citizens know that?
Well, you know, I'll tell you what my worry is at the CIA, even though Panetta's obviously an outsider and not an intelligence veteran or professional, but right underneath his layer, he's the very top, several of the people who were key to the torture program are still there. The people who set it up, supervised it, even some of the people who really were right in the room running it, and they are still in the agency. Nobody's been held accountable in any way. And I think that, you know, I don't believe that we're going back there. I think that we have broken with that past, But I think those people have a very vested interest in advising Obama not to look back. I think that some of the advice he's getting about why it's important not to look back comes from people who specifically don't want their own records looked at.
Mm-hmm. One of the points you make in the book is that some of the use of torture has actually tainted the prosecutions of various Guantanamo and other detainees because it is a violation of our fundamental rights, including Khatani and others, and that high-level Bush administration officials like Susan Crawford have made that point. What do you think the overall implication of the use of torture will be to bringing these people to justice? Has it tainted the entire pool?
I mean, I really hope that, you know, I mean, it's amazing to me. If you look at polls, about half the country still thinks that torture is acceptable in some circumstances. And I hope that what becomes clearer to people is the result of America's experiment with this during the Bush years is that we're really having a hard time prosecuting possibly very dangerous people who are down in Guantanamo because their rights have been so violated. So to me, the mess that Obama's left with down there in Guantanamo is the verdict on the torture program. And the verdict is it's a disaster in terms of justice in this country because you've got people like you mentioned Khatani. Muhammad al-Khatani is one of maybe three people who were said to be the 20th hijacker. I think maybe he actually was. But he is somebody who was tortured in so many different ways, according to Susan Crawford, a Republican Bush appointee who was in charge of prosecutions down in Guantanamo. She acknowledged it herself. This man was tortured by the United States, so much so that she said she did not think he can be prosecuted at this point. So you've got somebody who might actually have been part of this plot, one of the only surviving people who's part of this plot, who we can't prosecute because of what was done to him. And I think that is just, you know, the complete verdict on this program. And I hope anybody who thinks that torture is a good idea thinks about it in the long run, because the long run is exactly this. So.
You're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program, and our guest today is Jane Mayer, New Yorker correspondent and author, who is discussing the U.S. national security and challenges to constitutional rights. We have a number of questions here about how the expansion of the presidential powers occurred and what were the precipitating causes of that, and how far into illegality we actually moved, in your views. Could you comment on that?
Okay, well, I have to say I'm not a lawyer, and you are, so I hesitate to say what's illegal. I mean, in truth, one of the things that surprised me doing this book was, as a non-lawyer, I thought it would be clear when you're breaking the law, but apparently it's not. You know, you can argue almost anything, and that's what happened. There's this small office in the Justice Department, the Office of Legal Counsel, that seems obscure but turns out to be very key, was manned by political appointees with extreme views of what presidential power could include. And they believed that, as I said earlier, that the president could do pretty much anything if he was acting in the name of defending the country. And so it was quite like Nixon's statement, if the president does it, it's not illegal. And that seemed to be their argument. And I interviewed Arthur Schlesinger Jr., the historian, in the year before he died, and I was asking him about this because there have been other presidents, obviously, who've overstepped the bounds on civil liberties and other statutes.
Including some of our very great presidents.
Some of our great presidents, Lincoln, who suspended habeas corpus during the Civil War, and Franklin Roosevelt, who interned the Japanese and Japanese Americans. And so I was asking Schlesinger, can you just excuse Bush as being just another president who is, you know, overreacting in times of great duress? And he said the difference from his standpoint was that Bush's lawyers and Bush constructed a doctrine around this. They took the worst examples from American history, Lincoln and FDR, and they turned it into a presidential prerogative. They said it's the president's right to suspend civil liberties when the country's threatened. And Schlesinger said when Lincoln did it, Congress was not in session. As soon as Congress came back in session, Lincoln went and apologized. FDR, it's seen by almost every historian as the single darkest blot on his record. But what the Bush administration did was take these worst moments in U.S. history and turn them into a doctrine of presidential rights. And so it became a much more dangerous argument.
One of the points you make in the book is that the Congress did pass some emergency legislation, but there was carefully crafted language that was supposed to be a limitation of some sort on the presidential powers.
Yeah, there was a give and take on this that was quite amazing. Congress, they wrote up the authorization to use military force right after 9/11, which turned the war on terror into a war, was what the White House wanted. And the White House asked them specifically to extend the battle zone to America, saying, we want to be able to use these powers in our own country to, for instance, override the Fourth Amendment and the right to, be free from unreasonable searches and seizures. We want to be able to use these powers here in this country. And the Senate said, forget it. We're, the battle zone is out there. It's not here. But after the White House lost and was unable to convince Tom Daschle, in particular, to change the wording in the bill, the White House went ahead and got that same wording from the Justice Department secretly in secret memos. So they basically extended the battle zone on their own
through legal interpretation.
Right. So, and it was those legal memos that allowed them to override the FISA laws and do warrantless wiretapping in the country.
Now, as you said, you're not a lawyer, and you're a reporter of the facts, not a policymaker. But based on all the work you've done and the detailed materials that you've looked at, if you had to assess accountability for the development of our torture program, where would you put that?
Ooh. Well, I guess in the chain of command, you have to go right to the top. At the end of the day, this was a program, and the reason it was such a terrible program for this country is it was authorized by the top of our government. It was the president and the vice president signed off on this. So I suppose accountability goes to the very top of our government. I think that's the reason why Obama's reluctant to, open up some kind of investigation, because in the end of the day, it's going to end up with Bush and Cheney, and what is the proper way to handle that? And I think he'd argue it's at the ballot box, but I think that's the part of the problem here.
As you went through all of your materials, did you see any evidence that anyone in the administration was looking at the possibility of a terrorist attack as something that would actually give them the ability to increase the powers of the president? Or did you see it more as a reaction to, that the increased powers came as a reaction to the terrorist event?
Yeah, I didn't see anything quite so cynical as them ever hoping for any further attacks. I think instead that this was an instance where, and it's happened again and again in American history, when you have a national security emergency of some sort or another, executive power increases. And when there's a war, the chief executive becomes, commander in chief, and there are all kinds of enhanced powers that click in. So basically what happened in the White House was there were no breaks after 9/11. There was one party rule at the time in Congress. The courts were largely conservative, and Congress just rolled over and let the White House do what it wanted to do and asked almost no questions. So, and that's why we're seeing this back and forth over Nancy Pelosi.
Mm-hmm. We have a number of questions here about particular individuals, and the, history is always made by the particular people who are on the scene. One person that early on seemed to have responsibility to lay out the scope of additional powers that the president wanted to take up was a man named Kofor Black.
Kofor Black.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Could you comment a little bit on his influence and what that did?
Kofor Black was the head of the counterterrorism office in the CIA, and he's a sort of has sort of the aura of a cowboy. I don't know if he really is one. He sort of got the you know, this bull neck and crew cut, and looks like kind of a 1950s CIA agent with, you know, white shirt and dark suit. And anyway, he was the man who basically said, "We've got to take the gloves off." And he had felt constrained earlier by laws that had stopped the CIA from being able to pursue Al-Qaeda lethally. And so right after 9/11, he wrote up kind of his, they called it the Blue Sky Memo, everything he wished the CIA could do if you took the gloves off. And he handed it to the White House, and Bush, in effect, signed it almost on the spot. And what it allowed the CIA to do was to set up paramilitary teams to hunt, to capture, to kill, and if they, you know, or if they capture, to interrogate and detain terror suspects. It really gave the CIA a role that it never had before, because the CIA had not been in the business of interrogating or jailing people. In our government, the interrogators are usually the police or the FBI or the military, but not the CIA. So it put the CIA in the driver's seat, and Kofor was at the helm of that in the beginning. So he's a Californian.
Obviously, you've
he left, I should say, the White House after. It was 2000, and quite early on, he got very carried away with this to the point that people got scared by it almost. And he left, was kind of pushed out after 2002 and went to work in a company called Blackwater.
One source that you've used quite a bit is the 9/11 Commission. I just wondered what you thought of the quality of that report and how whether it was accurate, and what else you thought the commission should have done, if there is anything.
I think the 9/11 Commission report is fantastic. I mean, it's a really a model of fact finding. So I found it really useful. I think people don't realize how much is in it. It's a little bit hard to read, but if you go through it, it's filled with incredible nuggets, including the story I was telling earlier about how the two hijackers slipped in because the CIA failed to talk to the FBI. It does fall short in one way. I think it did purposefully, which was it draws no conclusions. If you read the report, you would draw conclusions that are incredibly damning about the performance of our government before 9/11. And it doesn't do that. I think it stopped short because it was a bipartisan commission, and every conclusion that it would have drawn would have had to have been agreed upon by both the Republicans and the Democrats. And I think they just thought it was too hard to come up with the proper wording that everyone could sign off on. But if you read it, you'll come to your own conclusions, I think, that are really scathing.
You know, one of the things, and we did get an audience reaction when we were talking about it, but obviously the story is not completely written on what is going to happen to the Guantanamo detainees. What, based on your research, do you think should happen, and what is going on now with respect to those prisoners?
Well, I just interviewed somebody at the White House this morning about it, trying to figure out where it is, because anybody following this closely will know that there have been stories in the New York Times and the Washington Post over the last couple of weeks saying that Obama is on the verge of signing something that's going to allow for indefinite detention of terror suspects down in Guantanamo without trial, without charges or trial. And yet, I have to say, when I first started covering this after Obama took office, I spoke to the White House counsel, Greg Craig, who said he just couldn't imagine that Obama would ever sign such a thing. So what's going on? I think there's a fight going on, and I don't think they know exactly what they're going to do yet. But from what I can tell, the process is first they're trying to sort out who they've got down in Guantanamo. There are people down there who for a long time they didn't even know during the Bush years anything about some of these prisoners. They didn't even have names on some of the files. They just had numbers on some of the files because they picked up people so randomly. But at any rate, first they're going to sort the people. They're trying to distribute anybody who is innocent, as they did with the Uyghurs recently. They are then going to try to charge anybody they can charge, either in the federal court system in the U.S. or in some military system that they're still devising. And if there are people who they feel they can't do any of these things with, that's where they're going to face this issue of whether or not they're going to find a way to hold them. And it sounds to me like they are going to find some, you know, or argue that they have this authority. But they're going to argue it quite differently from what Bush did. Bush argued that because he was president, he had this authority inherently to designate people as enemy combatants and hold them indefinitely till the end of the conflict. What Obama is saying is Congress passed the authorization to use military force, and in that bill, in that legislation, Congress said there's a certain category of people that we're at war with. They are the people who devised the 9/11 attacks or supported them substantially and are part of those organizations, either Al-Qaeda or the Taliban, which harbored them. And anybody in that category, under the laws of war, they're going to argue you could conceivably hold until the end of this conflict. I think if they do it, they're going to get a great pushback from the human rights world. But they are arguing it under the laws of war and under congressional authority. And so they're not just sort of saying we have monarchical powers to do these things. I'm sure they are hoping that there is nobody that falls into that category. But again, the problem is, it's the problem of the mistakes that were made before. I mean, it's not moving forward and saying they're going to capture terrorist suspects and do this to them. They're saying, we've got people whose rights are violated who we're afraid to let out, and we don't know how we're going to try them. And because all the evidence is tainted against them, all the evidence comes from tortured confessions, that's what they're potentially looking at. Mm-hmm. So, I don't know how many people fit into that category. I'm hoping for everybody's sake, nobody, but that's what they're looking at.
Yeah. For those of you just joining us on the radio, you're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California, and our guest today is Jane Mayer, New Yorker correspondent and author, who is discussing U.S. national security and challenges to constitutional rights. Many have argued that the torture of prisoners and other activities that we've engaged in as a country abroad have impacted our self-esteem and national reputation. I'm just wondering whether you agree and what the Obama administration has or can do about that.
Well, certainly polls show that respect for America has plummeted. And you know, I think that's a terrible shame around the world. I think there was one poll I looked at where the only countries where the general population supported us in the war on terror were the only countries were Russia and India. And the other problem is that some of the worst countries in the world are now citing our example as an excuse for their bad example. So you've got Mubarak in Egypt saying, you see, we told you you need to do these things, and saying it justifies their approach, which is, you know, very harsh and not exactly due process in Egypt. So there have been heavy costs paid. I think the best way to fix it is to fix it, which is, I think, what Obama's trying to do. But I think they've got to close Guantanamo. And the UN High Commissioner on Human Rights came out just this last week saying, you have to close Guantanamo. And I think that she's right in making that argument. It's going to be hard to fix this black eye until we just really move away from these policies. Problem is, you know, obviously Congress has thrown a fit about the notion of bringing Guantanamo prisoners into the United States, which is not making it any easier for Obama.
Obviously, the Obama has signed the Guantanamo papers, but what about all the other secret camps and torture programs around the world? Do you believe at this point that they've been terminated?
Or you mean the United States?
United States?
I do. I think they've closed all the black site prisons and that the CIA had, and Leon Panetta told me himself that he had fired the contract interrogators, including the military psychologists who had been hired by the CIA. It was surprising to me, though. He said that he'd only recently done so. That means that the people who devised this torture program, it turns out, were on the U.S. payroll until February, I think, of this year. After Obama took office, they were still on the U.S. payroll, and they've been making a ton of money. Those contract interrogators in this awful program are made out like bandits. So I wouldn't mind seeing them pulled up in front of Congress and having to ask a few questions,
questions. Are they mostly American companies, or are they?
They are Americans. They are based in Spokane.
You know, you've actually, the book has now come out in paperback. It's been out in hard copy for a year?
About a year.
A year. What has been the reader reaction to your book?
You know, because I'm an investigative reporter, I often wind up writing tough stories that the subjects of my stories don't necessarily love. But in this instance, it's been really gratifying. I've heard from an awful lot of people who are in this book who've called and said they loved it and that it was a service. And I felt really great about that, actually. So I don't think Cheney probably agrees, though, and he's
haven't heard from him.
He will be writing his own book, and if I raid on his radar at all, it won't be in the most flattering light.
Could you talk just a minute about how you managed to pull this incredible book together and all of the you've obviously cited from many sources, from many directions. What motivated you to do it, and how did you get all that done?
Well, partly what motivated me was that in doing the stories I did for The New Yorker, I knew something that most readers couldn't tell, which was it was impossible to do those stories without the help of people on the inside who were pushing back against these policies. So when I wrote this book, I wanted to write about not just what went wrong, but some of the amazing people who showed courage in fighting back. And there were people at every turn. There were FBI agents, there were soldiers, military lawyers, top lawyer in the Navy, Alberto Mora was one of the heroes of this book. There were even Republican lawyers inside the Bush Justice Department who simply said, this is not something that we should be doing, and really fought a good fight on the inside. Jack Goldsmith and James Comey were two of those lawyers. And it was a frightening thing for them to do. I mean, in fact, those two lawyers were so intimidated by Cheney and his lawyer, David Addington, that they thought that they might be stopped from trying to pull out, they were trying to withdraw the torture memo that authorized these programs. And so they got to the point where when they talked about it with each other on the phone, they talked in a code because they thought they were being eavesdropped on and that somehow they might be in danger, which is kind of incredible if you think about it. Two of the top lawyers in our Justice Department feeling that way, who were themselves Republican political appointees. So I wanted to tell the story not just of how things went wrong, but of the people that stood up and fought back, because to me they were very inspiring people. So,
do you think that during these years they actually made a difference, or were they pretty well stifled by what was going on?
Well, I don't think they made a difference right away. But in the end, I do. I mean, and I think that, you know, we're coming out of the dark side here, gladly. But they did withdraw the torture memo. Jack Goldsmith did, and he shut down the waterboarding. And there was an inspector general in the CIA whose report is still supposed to be coming out any day now. It's been a secret report, but that report, which was circulated internally in 2004, was such a killer report, apparently, that it just shocked a number of people who thought, you know, we can't be doing these things. And the Inspector General actually said he thought that this program was possibly criminal, probably criminal, and that scared the CIA out of wanting to keep going because they didn't want to be out on a legal limb.
So. Did you yourself feel threatened at any time in doing your investigation, or have anyone tell you you should stop doing this book?
No. No, not at all. But some of my sources, I think, were under great strain. And I think the worst thing for me was that there were people who became subject of leak investigations, which was a horrible price to pay. And nobody, I can say, leaked me classified information, but they were becoming subjects of leak investigations simply because they were leaking information that was politically, not what the administration wanted. They had to hire lawyers. They had to face the possibility of being prosecuted for espionage in one case. So this is really a terrible thing. You know, if reporters can't interview people.
Mm-hmm. If you think ahead about 5 years and or to 10 years, looking back on the Bush administration, the political issues that were, the war on terror and the political issues that were attendant, what do you think the judgment of history is going to be?
I think the judgment of history is going to be very harsh about this. I think this was a terrible departure for the country to have an authorized program of torture. And there are people who will still argue this is not torture, but I think it's kind of a silly semantic game at this point. Waterboarding up until the Bush administration was prosecuted as a crime and was considered torture, and people went to jail for it. And once our Attorney General defines it as torture, and once Susan Crawford, the top Bush legal figure down in Guantanamo, defines it as torture, I do too. And I think, I think this is going to be a shameful period to look back on.
We've been talking about the torture, but there were also other aspects of the war powers that went beyond what had been done in the past. If you had to kind of itemize those that you felt were beyond the pale, which in addition to torture would you identify?
Well, I think the warrantless wiretapping is a scary proposition. I don't know all the details still, though. But interestingly, I have interviewed somebody who does know all the details of this program, and he's an apolitical person, a kind of a technical person, but he knows a lot about it. And he said, in that warrantless wiretapping program, we have learned nothing. It's not, for all the cost to our legal system, it's not produced good intelligence. It's so broad in what they pick up. It sweeps up so much information that they have trouble even processing it. And it's not led to any kind of breakthroughs in stopping terrorist operations.
We could circle back again to the whole notion of looking back if you were to identify the Bush administration officials that were the most ultimately responsible, who would those be?
Well, again, I mean, there are things we still need to know, but it seems to me that Cheney is one of the great supporters of this program, and that George Tenet, who's pretty much disappeared from the public view, the director of the CIA during this period, has been described to me. He didn't give me an interview for the book, but he's been described by even people who like him as way too eager to please. He was so anxious to do whatever was asked of him that he just simply jumped off a cliff when they asked him to jump off a cliff with the CIA and operate this program that was really dubious legally.
What other important officials of the Bush administration had personality characteristics or background that you think led into this?
Well, I mean, David Addington is a major figure in my book. He is the lawyer for Vice President Cheney. He was his his counsel and later his chief of staff. And it's interesting to think that just the power of someone's personality can have such an impact on history. He was he really sort of fits the description of a zealot. He may be as far right-wing as anybody I've covered in Washington, and I've been there since the Reagan administration. He is kind of a purist, and he is very bright, has photographic memory, and just absolutely bullied people to the point where they were so intimidated they didn't want to argue with him. So he had a tremendous impact, and he had also the power of Dick Cheney behind him. So as a two-step, the two of them were really, really put their imprint on all of this.
You know, when you read your book, it's very clear that the interpretations of legal issues by the Justice Department was a key part in the extent of the powers that the Bush administration pursued and acted upon.
Well, Addington very much dictated a lot of what those legal positions were. Even though, I mean, it was so strange when, as a reporter covering this, I kept hearing this name David Addington everywhere when I was reporting, and it made no sense. Why would the vice president's lawyer have his fingers all over everything? I mean, usually that's a somewhat obscure office, the counsel to the vice president. But everywhere you turned, it was there. And he actually had a nickname inside the Justice Department. They called him the octopus because his tentacles were everywhere. But he very much, he was the person who you can see had the influenced the decision to throw the Geneva Conventions out in terms of whether they had any bearing on how we handled the detainees. And you might remember the phrase that said that they were quaint. That was his phrase. And even though I think the name on that particular memo was Gonzalez, it was pretty much dictated, everyone who learned later, by David Addington. He also had a tremendous impact on John Yoo, the young lawyer who was over in the Office of Legal Counsel, who he worked very closely with. And he was so much more powerful of a personality than Alberto Gonzalez, who was first the White House counsel and didn't know anything about international law or national security law. And then when Gonzalez was when he became Attorney General of the United States, he was still quaking in front of David Addington. In the meetings that I describe in this book, you know, Gonzalez would sort of get geared up to maybe oppose Addington and then come back, you know, kind of whipped, having not really been able to do anything about it.
With hindsight, what changes could have been adopted at the time, or perhaps getting the courts involved? What do you think could have made a difference here?
Well, I mean, lawyers who understood not only the letter of the law, but the spirit of the law, and thought that it mattered. I mean, and lawyers, I think it's very important that government lawyers realize their client is not only the president of the United States and what he wants to do, but it's the whole country. So I think that the Justice Department has been reviewing the work of these lawyers, and there is an internal report that hasn't been released yet, but it too is said to be very damning about how they viewed their jobs. And hopefully in the future, lawyers in the Justice Department will make a better effort to truly guide the government in a way that is in the spirit of our Constitution.
You know, unfortunately, we've reached the point in our program where there's time only for one last question. And it's a question from our audience that asks or says, Cheney has said recently that the torture policies were an executive-level decision, and therefore the president would have been aware of them. What was, in your view, Bush's real role in all of this, his actual personal role?
You know, one of the strange things about working on this book is Bush keeps evaporating from the page. I kept, trying to find evidence of his role, and it's so clear that the real power behind this program, anyway, was Cheney as opposed to Bush. He certainly seemed gung-ho, but in some ways he seemed almost like he reverted to his role in, I guess he went to Andover, where he was the cheerleader. You know, I mean, it wasn't that he was the generator of many of these policies so much.
Well, our thanks to Jane Mayer, correspondent for The New Yorker and author of the book, The Dark Side, the inside story of how the war on terror turned into a war on American ideals. We also thank our audiences here and on radio, television, and the internet. Tonight's program has been part of the Commonwealth Club's U.S. Constitution in the 21st Century series, underwritten by the Charles Geske family. I'm Mary Cranston, and now this meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, celebrating more than a century of enlightened discussion, is adjourned.
Thank you.